So let's take this conversation forward as far as the last trading day of this year goes with Prateek Agarwal, who is joining us live. Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure talking to you. Now, if you look at the equity market's performance, boy oh boy, what a year it's really turned out to be, right? The Nifty 50 year-to-date returns of 23% plus. The mid-cap 150, 45% plus. Nifty small-cap 250, 60% plus. And you've had the metal stocks, the IT stocks being the outperformers. As you enter the new year, Mr. Agarwal, what are you telling your clients? Are you tempering their expectations? What ideas have you got for them so they continue to make this kind of money in 2022?
So, yes, we are tempering down their expectations. Valuations are sustainable, but they are not in the cheap territory anymore. The catch-up to value has happened over the last 2 years. But that said, we are very positive that this will again be a positive return year, a third year in succession. We are starting the year with lot of positive things. Macro looks positive. The forex side looks good. The fact that IT exports are now tending to be more than oil imports gives a lot of strength to forex reserves, the direction of the currency, and so on. Our fiscal position is strong. So it's a good mix of macro which should hold the valuations. But that said, with a 15% kind of earnings increase that is expected in 23 over 22, something that the market will discount as we go deeper into the new year. I think in terms of expectation setting, we are telling our investors to expect less than earnings growth kind of returns. So 10 to 15% kind of a range is what I really expect the markets to deliver.
It's so interesting you're saying that because, after 10 long years, the CapEx cycle, at least in the private sector, seems to be real. The profit pool seems to be real. And you're saying, returns below earnings.
Yeah, mostly to do with, start point of valuations. But otherwise, we are on a pretty good wicket. And I keep saying, unless we shoot ourselves in the foot, we have a pretty long runway of sustained growth. So, like you said, CapEx cycle is starting. The government was always doing its bit. State government have started to participate as well. The households, the house buying activity is the biggest CapEx the households do, and that's turned buoyant. I think corporate CapEx of the usual kind will take some time, while the PLI induced corporate CapEx is really starting to happen as well. So, and apart from CapEx, please remember the recovery that we have had is a K-shaped recovery. So there is one section which has done well and is pulling the economy up, and it's already over the pre-COVID levels. Now, as the other part, which hasn't as yet participated as strongly, comes back into the job stream, starts to get their incomes back, they will drive the consumption growth going forward. So in terms of overall macro, I think we have a pretty good story, versus many other economies, many other large economies globally. The only problem that I can see is the start point of valuations. Had they been cheap, we would have made a case for better than earnings growth. But since the start point is even maybe a tad on the higher side, we are saying, give market time to come back to its normal valuations and, expect less than earnings growth kind of returns for a few years.
Sony, come. just looking at what really the year gone by has been in terms of various sectors as well as individual stocks, and you know, metals clearly has actually led the charts on a year-to-date basis. I mean, the Nifty Metal has surged up 67%, and that's a mighty move. But the interesting thing here is that the move in metals came in the first half of the year. That kind of performance that you saw in the first half didn't quite replicate it in the latter part. So I just wanted to understand whether or not in terms of valuations and the run-up that they have had, is the best behind us, or because of the underperformance recently, there is a chance that metals may actually rise up further?
See, metal businesses typically are valued on price to book. You know, the start point was 0.4, 0.5, 0.6 price to book kind of levels, and you know, yes, the stocks did very well, but now they are 1.1, 1.3 kind of a range. At this, you know, the valuations are complete to any traditional valuers. You know, if you even look at how M&A happens in the metal space, it happens at these kind of valuations or lower, which then means that while the earnings may stay strong, you know, as we speak, energy prices are shooting up in Europe. You know, for example, aluminium producers are reducing production, which has a positive connotation for aluminium prices and hence producer profitability. But what happens is, you know, the increase in profits is all that is reflected in the stock price. The stock prices do not ascribe a multiple to such profits, you know, because on valuations we are already full. These kind of profits are seen to be temporary, not sustainable. Now, if there is a change in view to this, you know, and it will require a lot to change that view, only then can you see a sustained upside in metals. Otherwise, I think what will be reflected is, you know, if you make a quarter of supernormal profits, whatever supernormal profits you have made gets added to the price, kind of a situation.
Pratik, the other thing is, you know, pharma actually has been a relative underperformer, and I was just looking at the performance there as well. Along with FMCG, pharma has had a meager 3-odd% move as a sector all through 2021. Now, of course, this comes on the back of an extremely rip-roaring 2020. But that said, now with the Omicron as well as the third wave, fear really looming large, and one is already seeing that, you know, there is a flight towards the pharmaceutical names. Do you think pharma has a chance or potential to actually play catch up? And when I say pharma, I'm obviously including the larger healthcare services space as well into it.
So pharma, I think let's divide it into India branded businesses focused on India, generic businesses focused on, let's say, a developed market like the US, and the API manufacturers. In the first round, it was the branded generics and the generic exporters which did well. In the second round, it was the API guys who did very well. The regulatory oversight, the pushbacks are coming back for the guys focused on the Western market, and that's a risk that is difficult to quantify and price. So you can have only as much exposure to that part of the pharma value chain. I think a space where growth would be stronger, where profitability is returning on account of China plus one or whatever factors, on account of PLI support as well, is the API space. For people who are focused there, who have survived the great carnage of the late 90s, early 2000s, are in a good position. So in the pharma space, I think I would focus more on the API part. Yes, it has its commodity character, you know, prices may move up and down, a bit, but that I think will have to be taken in the stride. This is a part which may deliver much better earnings growth, much more sustained manner over next few years, without as much of regulatory issues.
Prateek, what about IT? Like, you began this interview with talking about overstretched valuations. Middle of 2021, we started saying, hey, isn't IT too expensive? But even if you look at an Infy, it's given a return of what? Almost 50% year to date. TCS, 25% year to date. Tech Mahindra, 89% year to date. And you know, with the new uncertainty that we have in thanks to the new COVID variant, etc., how should someone look at the IT sector? And I'm not even getting into the mid-tier companies. I wouldn't even mention the top-tier ones right now.
No, so IT, when the year started, had a different combination that was being presented in front of fund managers and research analysts. See, last year was a great, last year meaning 21 was a great year for IT businesses. They cut costs while the business outlook remained strong. 22 was theoretically a year where costs would have come back, markets would have opened, people would have come back into offices, travel would have started and so on. Now, because of the virus, because of various reasons, I would say costs didn't come back to the same extent. And on the other hand, beginning of the year, people thought 14-15% growth in sales is good number to look at. That outlook kept on getting better and better as the year progressed. So much so that somebody like an Accenture comes in and talks of a 22 kind of percent growth for the future, which is very, very strong for a business of that size. Now, the challenge in IT is that, yeah, cost didn't come back this year, but will they not come back next year? For how long can the growth of close to 20% or so, above long period average growth, so continue? Because ultimately, it is an expense item for the company. They allocate a certain number. They can increase it for a year or two, it won't be forever. So that is where the challenge for IT comes in. But as we speak, it is very, very strong. It will continue to be strong for a year or two, at least. That is what we are gathering. So even somebody like us who were not invested there are invested in IT at the present. In IT, the other section, which is the online businesses, I think going gets better for them as well. The longer people stay at home and work from home, the better it becomes for such businesses as people's habit change in a much more sustained manner. So that is something that we have to take in a stride. IT, by the way, has lot of rub-off on other sectors. It's now 8% of GDP. So look at it this way, one of the largest part of India's GDP, and forget agriculture and all of that, would be growing the strongest, 15-20%. It's a labor intensive and relatively higher paying labor intensive part of the economy. The space would employ over next 3 years what it did over last 7-8 years, kind of a situation. So the income effect that will happen from IT, and they retain nothing, it's paid off as wages, some bit as expenses, whatever profits are there is paid off as taxes or as dividends, with less than 10-15% retained in the company itself. So the multiplier IT has on the economy now with its large presence in the economy is going to be more and more felt as we go forward. That does feed into our outlook for next year. It has multipliers for consumption part, it has multipliers for real estate, both commercial and residential, and what goes into it.
Before we let you go, we've been asking all of our guests this question. So as we enter 2022, and very quickly, since we're running out of time, and I apologize for saying that, what would you buy, sell, hold?
Where will you?
What will you buy? What will you sell? What will you hold?
Yeah. So 22 in many ways is a continuum of 21 with the same themes continuing into 22. So PLI, China plus one, etc. I think the two spaces which may come back in a stronger manner is one, consumption, consumers. So they got hit by inflation in financial 22. As we go forward, inflation gets addressed, margins may expand for this space. And well, like you said, they have done very little this year. Maybe the next year would be better. So that is one space to look at. We are looking there. It's always been a 20-odd% plus exposure for us. The other space is financials. I think as COVID situation retreats to the background, as the regulatory changes gets digested over the next one quarter or so, and as the NSE and LIC issues are behind us, the rest of the year, should prove to be once again a comeback year for financials. They have had a pretty, not so good year in terms of return generation. So those are the two spaces to look at least to my mind. Spaces to avoid is commodities, metals, and I did make a case for that in the earlier part.
Okay, so those are the buy, sell, hold ideas from Pratik Agarwal. Thank you so much for joining us live today on 31st of December. Here's wishing you, your entire team and family a very happy New Year.
Very happy New Year. Bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, entering the new year, we've spoken to the